this concept, believe it or not, miserablism isn't necessarily unhappy, although we'll be saying lots about that. What we do look at film, but we also look at literature. We're sort of interdisciplinary, we're looking across lots of things, and we'll introduce it as a concept, doing a double act tonight, myself and Eleanor. So what is miserablism? Wretched, exceedingly unhappy, causing misery, very poor or mean, the concise English dictionary. A drowsy addiction to an imagined injury, Andrew O'Hagan. Scots miserablism, marked out by the tragic tone miserablist screenworks, depict the lives of violent and addicted anti-heroes set against the backdrop of post-industrial hopelessness, urban squalor and decay, where redemption and forgiveness seem impossible without exile from Scotland, and where the hero struggles to develop tools or strategies to ultimately overcome his misery or temptations. And that's by my partner in this book, Eleanor Yule. So what is our interpretation of this concept? Well, we take the view that it's something to do with gender, a great deal to do with national identity, which is kind of handy with the referendum coming up, and distinctly Scottish culture, something to do with religion a little bit, but most of all to do with our own lack of control over the images that portray us. It isn't just political, it's also psychological. If our arts are what we dream of ourselves, what is the national psyche of our nation? Well, we're about to play a clip, and before we play it, I'd just like to say that in the Quaker Meeting Hall, it's a bit controversial, but it's the only controversial clip we have using language which possibly the Quaker Meeting Hall is not used to. But you'll recognise it. We put it on because it's an iconic clip. So I'm sure you'll recognise it. So here we go.
It's a great score! It's great here! This will make you proud to be Scottish!
It's shy being Scottish!
And the lowest of the low! The scum of the fucking earth! Most wretched, miserable, servile, pathetic trap that was ever shot in civilisation! Some people in the English are going, they're just wankers! We on the other hand are colonised by wankers! Can't even find a decent culture to be colonised by! We're ruled by a few arseholes! It's a shite state of affairs to be in, Tommy, and all the fresh air in the world won't make any fucking difference!
Most of you, did everybody hear that? I'm sorry that it's a bit low, but you get the picture, yeah? That basically he's not overjoyed to be Scottish. And that's from Irvine Welsh's 1996 film Trainspotting, directed by Danny Boyle. And what's really interesting about this clip is that Tommy, the character at the beginning, played by Kevin the Kid, tries to drag these guys out of Edinburgh, which is kind of, they live in a kind of urban mess, injecting drugs. And what he's doing is he's trying to take them out to the Scottish countryside to show them the beauty of Scotland, the fantastic landscape, the fresh air. And Tommy, the Kevin the Kid character, starts the narrative as a very functional human being with a girlfriend, with interests, playing football, sport, going for walks, not taking drugs. But by the end of this film, basically, he's the worst victim of all. I mean, he ends up basically dying of AIDS, having his eyes eaten out by cats because of worms in cats, basically, feces, and dying a horrible death. And that's Irvine Welsh's view of really what's happening to kind of Scottish youth and culture within the context of a miserablist universe. And so this is something that we'll go back to because this is kind of the arc, if you like, of the miserablist hero. And we'll be talking about what that arc is and how it's a story that we tell ourselves over and over again, not just in film, but also, as Dave will go on to point out, in literature as well. And so, you know, if Irvine Welsh's assessment of the Scottish psyche is correct, how did we get to this point? Turn our backs on our heritage, landscape, diversity, richness of culture, and redefine ourselves, not just as rivals with the English, but inferior. And when and how did we start to represent ourselves as cultural victims? I'm going to take you back to the beginning of the story of how I came across the concept of miserablism. And as you heard in the introduction, I'm a filmmaker myself and I've been working in the industry for 25 years in Scotland. I'm actually Scottish by birth, but like many people, many artists and creators in Scotland, my parents were actors in the 70s here and they could find no work, so they moved to England. And this is again something that we touch upon when we're talking about miserablism, is how Scotland, you know, it has been unable to keep much of its talent. And part of it is, again, this story that we tell about ourselves, that it's very, very difficult to grow within Scottish culture, that basically we need to go away to thrive. Within our culture itself, we will be stunted. And this is part of the miserablist myth. So basically, I started to hear the term miserablism bandied around in film development meetings in the kind of late 90s, where people would say, oh no, not another miserablist film. And it was quite interesting because, you know, if you try to pin somebody down and say, well, what exactly are you talking about? They would say, well, you know, it's grim, it's depressing, but there was no kind of definite definition of this. But it's really interesting because it has entered the popular imagination. For instance, in October 2011, the newspaper headlines were that miserablist films ruling at Scottish BAFTA. So it wasn't just in feature films, such as in Peter Mullen's Ned, and more recently you've seen Filth. And I'll talk about that being a particular kind of miserablism. But also, if you think of Ramsay Nesbitt, it can fall into that category. And the rise of poverty porn shows like The Scheme and making entertainment out of dysfunctional residences and Orthanc. A lot of this taps into the miserablist myth and has actually become quite a big national export. People are actually profiting from proliferating this myth of ourselves. So in 2009, I was at a kind of artistic residence and a kind of residential retreat, and somebody from the Glasgow Centre of Population Health approached me, and he said to me, so it wasn't from the film side of things or the art side of things, but it was from kind of more the social sciences. He said, I'm really interested in the way in which the projections of ourselves affect people's psyche. So how does it affect our self-esteem, for a start? And so he said to me, you know, what is the depiction of poverty within film? How are they doing it? What are they saying? And I said to him, what do you mean miserablism? And he said, well, I've never heard that, but could you go away and find out, could you do some research and find out exactly what that is? Some serious research. And certainly, I was extremely keen to do that because as a female film director, I felt that my voice on a number of occasions hadn't been heard. I put forward many, many different ideas, often with female protagonists, as a number of my friends had, only to find that, you know, for some reason it just didn't tick boxes, they weren't interested in it. And it was quite frustrating because you just kept seeing this same kind of miserablist narrative being rolled out. Yet, when it came to diversity, to other voices, women's voices, ethnic minorities, gay stories, middle class stories even, they weren't really being commissioned. So it was quite perplexing about what was actually happening. And I wanted to embrace this and look into it. So very recently, I was at the Edinburgh Film Festival there, and I picked up a pamphlet that was made in Scotland, and it was Scotland showing to the world the films it made since 2011. There were 22 films in it, not one single one was by a female director. So this isn't an old story, this is a current issue. So I think the research that I was going to do was going to be quite helpful, I think, in shining a light into what was actually really going on here. So we have, what I decided to do was actually do it as an academic, an impartial academic study. So I decided to undertake a content analysis of 50 to 60 films that I thought, you know, mainly fell into the category. And I sat down and I watched them, and I can tell you it was quite an ordeal. It would have been, but there are, within miserablism itself, of course, there's also a lot of amazing stuff. So I think it's really important that you understand that we're not saying that this whole thing is no good, because some of our great artists have come out of this genre, and some of the best art and innovation has come out of it. But the problem is it tells the same narrative story. It's got stuck within a certain kind of self-defeating narrative. So we're not saying that it's rubbish by any means, but we're just challenging the domination of it as a genre. So I sat down and I watched these 40 to 50 films, and basically I came up with 17 characteristics that constitute the Scottish Miserablist genre. But before we do that, we're going to have a little look at a roundup of a cross-section of the films that I watched as part of this study.
No.
was a bit more swearing, sorry about that. It's unavoidable, because that is in fact one of the 17 points of Scottish Miserablism. Okay, so here are the, so what we saw there was train spotting, Just Another Saturday by Peter McDougall and John McKenzie, 1972. The Rat Catcher, Lynn Ramsey, 1999. Sweet 16 was Ken Loach, and again, we finished with the clip of train spotting. Interestingly, about Lynn Ramsey, who is a female director, which is unusual for the Miserablist canon, she actually, her first three films, short films, one of them was award-winning in Cannes, were all female protagonists. But interestingly, when she came back to Scotland to work on the feature film, she suddenly is, and she gave a number of ideas. This one was the idea that was chosen with a male protagonist, set in the 1970s, which is a kind of, if you like, it's a nostalgic period for the Miserablists. They like to return to the 1970s again and again. So Peter Mullen does it in theirs, and Lynn Ramsey does it here. Outside of Scotland, she actually goes on to make really different kinds of films that are quite experimental and full of poetic realism. And it's interesting as well, if you think of somebody like Gillis McKinnon in Small Faces, again, he returns to Scotland to the nostalgia of his teenage years and the razor gangs and the violence and the dysfunctional families. But you know, outside of Scotland, he actually makes films like The Brass Arena, which are really quite redemptive. So again, we have to ask what's happening when our filmmakers are coming back to tell this, to also buoy up this narrative and keep telling it over and over again. So here are the 17 points for Scottish Miserablism, which I basically, most of these films have got. This is a male tragic working class hero, often a drifter and or hard man, struggling with addiction. Alcohol, drugs, gambling or violence are his fatal flaw. The motivating theme, the emotional drive of the film, is the desire for order or validation. The younger hero is often a rites of passage character who is ripped from childhood, often fatherless and initiated into a world of chaos, crime and addiction. Unemployment and economic deprivation play key roles in the Miserablist hero's motivation and the feeling he has no choice. Uncompromising violence, physical and or emotional, is part of the film's landscape territory. The hero comes from a historically dysfunctional extended family and or collapsed community. Secrets, lies, unforgiven misdeeds, a lack of redemption and the absence of hope within relationships characterize storylines in which the sins of the fathers are revisited upon the offspring. The influence and bleakness of the weather dominate the mise-en-scene, particularly darkness and rain. Women play secondary roles, often chastising the main protagonist and encouraging them to change but to no avail. They generally function as either enablers or co-addicts, joining in with the protagonist's self-destructive lifestyle. Black humour is used to sweeten the bitter pill. The dialogue is street language, indigenous to its setting, usually a well-observed Scots vernacular, the vocabulary dense with expletives. Urban squalor and industrial wastelands prevail as exterior settings. Interior settings revolve around utilitarian domestic spaces and the pub. Guilt and unconsciously repressed religious values often inform the actions of both the protagonist and the antagonist. This is a godless universe, but it is dominated by a superstitious and punishing form of fate. A sense of worthlessness is generated by the idea that a superior power has the upper hand, be it a gang, an addiction, or another nation, i.e. the English. The predominant style is naturalist, informed by both the Scots literary naturalist tradition and British social realist cinema. But interestingly, it's a subset of British social realist cinema, so things like Room at the Top, Saturday Night, Sunday Morning. But these things like the repressed religious values and the depth of the misogyny and the idea of cursing the sins of the fathers, these are much, much deeper within the Scottish version of the genre, which is interesting. It is quite distinct. Often in British social realist cinema, there is a feeling that people can get out of their situations, but it's not the case within the Scots version of the genre. Or if they do, then it, you know, there are consequent, really dire consequences. A limited number of restricted locations and use of non-celebrity actors meant that Miserablism lends itself to low-budget productions, which makes it an exportable national product. So this is interesting as well, because the Scots film industry has always been itself being within poverty. So it's actually much cheaper to make this kind of stuff. Often, you know, the actors are just local talent, they don't use trained actors, that kind of thing. What's funny about that, when you work in the industry, is you realise it's just as expensive to make a drugs den as it is to film, and actually cheaper often to film in somebody's middle class drawing room, which pre-exists. You know, so the economic argument is a bit dodgy. So, and then there is no escape, no matter how hard, you know, this is the most depressing point of all. And interestingly, to write this, because I felt very oppressed when I was writing it, as you can imagine, I decided to leave the country and go to France, where it's a bit sunnier and didn't rain so much. And when I was there, by coincidence, one of the kind of leading Scottish academics in film was actually also in this tiny little village, which I thought was, you know, a great, you know, act. It was very lucky that it was there. Anyway, I decided to run these points by him because he's, you know, he's very respected in the field. And I wanted to test my model out on someone. And he listened to it, and he agreed with absolutely everything. But he said, you've missed one point out. And he said, and it's the most significant of all. And it was the point I didn't want to see, because it's the most depressing. And it's the biggest reason why we have to challenge, especially on the run-up to the referendum, why we really have to challenge these narratives that we're telling about ourselves, and we're still doing it now. And this is it. There is no escape, and no matter how hard a Scottish miserablest hero tries, he is doomed to failure. The only alternative is to leave Scotland and never come back, or die, as you can see in some of these films. The message is that to survive change, the hero must live in exile from which he can never return. So we're telling, you know, unconsciously, we're planting these seeds within, and we're still doing it. Now, when we looked back, Dave's going to talk to you about, because what was really interesting about this is I was actually quite shocked by the results and what we were actually really telling ourselves. So then I got Dave involved because I realised that a lot of these films are adaptations from literary novels. And this goes way back, really way back into history, into Scottish history. It's very, very firmly embedded in the Scottish psyche for generations. Generational thing this. So it was really interesting to see what Dave was going to come up with looking into literature about where it was coming from. But what's really interesting is it absolutely, it seems to me, just to generalise, obviously you can read the book in more detail, but that this story was based in truth. This is a real truth for a lot of skilled working class men within Scottish history. You have the clearances, which is interesting, because the very first Miserablist film is about the clearance community. So you've got skilled working class Scots who are basically made impotent for the first time within the clearances. They then move into the central belt to pick up heavy industry, and it happens for a second time. You know, so this is a real deep-rooted chip on the shoulder here. And I talk about the Queen Mary being one of the greatest achievements, the ship of the skilled working classes in Scotland, but I also talk about what they're carrying as being a chip on the shoulder, the size of that ship. And when you think it was twice the size of the Titanic, that's a pretty big chip. Anyway, over to you, David.
Thanks. One of the great things about doing this project has been when I look back at these clips and these TV programmes that we all watched years ago and seeing how well we've changed, or have we changed? You know, it's very interesting, and it's been a delight to look at them and look at them in the context of the referendum, of course. Also try and do, as Ellen was describing, look at literature as something that connects to film. I don't think they're different at all. I think that they're stories we tell of ourselves in different forms, that's all. So when Eleanor asked me to look at the literary side of it, I went to my bookshelves and tried to pull down all the books that I thought might have miserablism in them. I might as well just have emptied the contents of all the shelves onto the floor, because I ended up with all the piles of books that I was moving them about, that was all it was. It doesn't mean that, as Eleanor was saying, I consider miserablism bad. It's not always bad. It's been a great addition to what we do. Some of the film clips you've seen here, we describe them as miserablist. Some of the books that I will describe as miserablist, I think are fantastic books. But they happen at particular moments when we needed them to happen. It's when they become diluted and repeated and the same thing again and again for no good reason that I think it starts to defeat itself. I think that there's probably a little doubt it's got something to do with Calvinism. If you read the sort of commentators like Cairns Craig, you'll see that they attribute the darkness in the Scottish tradition to something to do with religion. Cairns Craig attributes it generally to Calvinism, and there's not necessarily any proof of what I'm about to claim, but I think it's a fair claim to say that the thing that makes Calvinism distinguishable from other forms of Protestantism is the idea of predestination. That may exist in other parts of the world, but our own particular Scottish take in fanaticism is undoubtedly the belief that no matter what we do in this earth, we cannot go to hell, some of us. And on the other hand, those of us who are destined for hell can't by any act of goodness ever make ourselves go into heaven. Now that's a pretty severe psychic split, and it's got something to do with the way we regard ourselves. It must have. So it springs not from Protestantism itself, but from the fundamentalist strain within it, which I think was the idea of predestination. That doesn't mean that necessarily Scottish writers therefore became miserablists. Far from it. Miserablism as a genre, as an attitude, came about much later, in fact as a 20th century phenomenon. But we can see aspects of miserablism in things like Holy Willie's Prayer by Robert Burns, where we look at the hypocrite who is within society and who is raising himself up in terms of against other people, praising himself, seeing God as being on his side, and only on his side, not sharing with anybody, and sort of hiding within religion and benefiting from his own beliefs. Another book that I think is worthwhile of mentioning is undoubtedly one that people talk about all the time, Private Memoirs and Confessions of a Justified Sinner by James Hogg. And interestingly, more recent books like James Robertson's The Fanatic refer to this the idea of the tortured Robert Ringham, who is unable to save himself no matter what he does. And Robert falls in with the devil, but mistakes him for a friend. And I'd argue that it's his belief in fundamentalism that deceives him. So James Hogg, although he included miserablism in his work, isn't saying it can't be counted as a miserablist himself, nor can Robert Burns. They knew it for what it was. Nor am I saying that religion equals it. Far from it. The Kailyard era, which came at the end of the 19th century, can hardly be called miserablist. But that did have much to do with the flowering of miserablism. These small town idylls have been unjustly accused, I think, of perpetuating sentimentality. They've been called unreadable. I don't really think that they are. They're not as bad as they've been touted. But they are undoubtedly looking backwards in a nostalgic way to something that was probably vanishing at the time, the small town Scottish life, which was being dismantled by the forces of the Industrial Revolution. It's more the reaction against them which began miserablism as a force. In one particular book, The House with the Green Shutters by George Douglas Brown in 1901. And this is an extract from the book. George Douglas Brown's The House with the Green Shutters, that's our book, Eleanor's and mine, I mean, savage this light school of literature. There are no open references to the Kailyard, but at the book's opening, a well-kept picture of a Scottish small town, Dawn, lulls the reader into believing that this will be another sentimental tale. The freshness of the air, the smoke rising thin and far above the red chimneys, the sunshine glistening on the roofs and gables, the rosy clearness of everything beneath the dawn, above all the quietness and peace made Barbie, usually so poor to see, have any pleasant place to look down at. As soon as he knew this would be a very different sort of story, Gourley smiled grimly, and a black gleam shot from his eye. So George Douglas Brown sets us up to believe this is a Haleyard story, and then he brings in something very different. The house with the green shutters deliberately and consciously breaks with Haleyard conventions. The setting is a small village with a local cast of characters, but it's a picture of people in a place and a time that is dark, foreboding, and malign. It's not optimistic about the future at all. Change is coming, and change is very much for the worse. The struggle is for power between John Gourley and his competitors, but it is clear from early in the book that Gourley's plans for himself and his family are doomed. A grandly dark tale with strong Gothic elements is acted out, describing a decline inevitable from the start, all the more ironic for being set in a tiny, inward-looking world. The story's outcome is foreshadowed and inexorable in its consequences, its main events echoed mockingly or insinuatingly by a chorus of lazy, malicious bodies, the villagers. Bodies. It's not an optimistic book, as those of you, and many of you will have read it, can testify. And it's got much to do with the time when it was written, a new century, loss of certainty, loss of religion, war looming, all sorts of ways in which George Douglas Brown was responding to what was happening in the wider world, but also happening in this small town. And I think it's a great book for myself because it manages to convince us that this utter division between lightness and darkness happens in such a small, backward place. Indeed, that's one of its points. But it's also the opening of Miserablism. Other novels like Hayes Gillespie followed suit. And began to echo the same tone, and indeed this tone was to last throughout the 20th century, strongly in Scottish literature as well as other places. These books sold much less than the Haleyard novels that had preceded them. They didn't have anything like the same amount of sales, they weren't as known internationally, but they had much greater impact, and they impacted on our consciousness in a much greater way, I think, and had much to do with the way we see ourselves now. So the First World War book paid to the 19th century, and during it I think we can see Miserablism take hold. In John Buchan's Mr. Standfast, his third shocker, we move from small town portrayals to the hellish city, which was to be the spiritual home of Miserablism, and still is. And the hellish city is a particular one in Mr. Standfast, it's Glasgow. And Glasgow and the portrait of Glasgow and Miserablism is something that is still with us. It's hung over Glasgow in many ways. It's hung over representations of Glasgow that we saw on screen just there to a large extent. And whether they're true or untrue, it's something that Glasgow has forever been tagged with ever since, and probably ever always will be. In Buchan's Mr. Standfast, the setting is during the First World War. And Richard Hannay, in this book, is quite a repressive figure. He changes as the books develop. But in this particular book, he's an undercover spy flushing out shirkers and possible spies. And he visits the black tenements of Glasgow, shrinking into himself as he treads up the closed stairs, because, like all South Africans, I have a horror of dirt. And he keeps a close eye for anything less than warlike in a city already brutally repressed. And that's the point. This guy, Richard Hannay, going around looking for possible deviations from the norm in a city that's clearly already completely clamped down on. Violence is praised, young men are policed by other males, expected to sign up if they're not already working in the munitions industries. It's a probably faithful portrait of the city on a war footing, with everything bent to the war effort, and no silly little upstart nationalism allowed. And it's also the start of the Glasgow hard man, who was going to inflict her Vienna screen dramas in her books ever afterwards, and still is. So this armour-plated version of Glasgow was to last into peacetime, with MacArthur and Kingsley Long's No Mean City, probably the archetypal Miserablist work, and one which has ever since attached the grim city label to Glasgow, one which later writers, many of them Miserablists themselves, had to struggle against. So I went through these books and I looked for Eleanor's 17 points of Miserablism. And I've got to be 8 or 9, 10, I call it a Miserablist work. Well, No Mean City ticks every one of those boxes, and probably double-tick lots of them. We follow the career of Johnny Stark, the Razor King, as Gordon slums in the 1920s, his life and loves in single ends, filthy closet beds and stairs, and his battles with the rival gangs of Plantation and Townhead. It's not by any means a bad book. I don't know if any of you have read it recently or come across it. I mean, it's often condemned and in many ways held us back for many years. Writers in the 60s and 70s were trying to throw it off, possibly still are. But it's just such a dead end. There's clearly no way out for the people in these places. Eleanor made the point that exile is impossible for Scottish people, and again I found this. We're not able to leave, and this picture comes out in No Mean City as well. But I've also had chats with people who remember those times, and they say, well, that was actually what it was like. Do you know, there really was no way out. So I'm not saying this is unfaithful, I'm not saying this is wrong, I'm just saying that it was all this time that we have more diverse representations that we can make of ourselves now. The book portrayed Glasgow in a way it's never been able to shake off. Sons, wives and daughters of unemployed drunken workers and main deck soldiers with nothing to do but working menial jobs or loaf the streets fill the same slums as Mr. Standfast. Exactly the same place. 10 years of a difference between the writings of the book, maybe 15, just exactly the same descriptions. They're boredom punctuated by bouts of drinking, violence and sex. And it's a desperately hard life and probably a faithful one. These are the lost souls, the damned. But there's no way out for any of them, only acceptance of their condition or death. Two characters, the gangster McClatchy and John Gray, beaten by Stark in fights, slink from the town. But their leaving is part of their punishment, a particularly shameful one. Neither the Razor King, nor his brother Peter, nor Bobby Hurley the dancer escape their fates, and women appear only in secondary roles. Actually, in Mr. Standfast, I don't think women appear at all. Sort of the tea is laid, but you know, that's all you see, really, in sort of tenement settings. They do appear in No Mean City, but their fates are mirror the men's and are much worse than the men's. They have even fewer opportunities. So even although two people leave this grim city, it's a shameful thing to leave. Other than that, everybody is nailed to their fate. There's simply no way out. It wasn't just in prose that miserablism took hold. Indeed, the general concern was to look at Scotland the way it was, rather than through the lens of what was seen to be misleading romantic myths. So McDermott and the Scottish Renaissance were very much about throwing out what had been in the 19th century looking back before that. But I feel that probably McDermott has been unfairly tagged as a miserablist, or he can be too easily seen as a miserablist. His work was much more complex and he was always open to new influences. Of all poets, he was the one who was able to take on influences from all over the world. He wasn't rejecting the outside world at all, not inward looking. He did have his tendency to fly off the handle every now and again in print, and that often gave the impression that his way was the only way. But there was a great deal of irony in it. He was also very helpful to younger poets. But I think that maybe a work of that time that we can see as more miserablest is Edmund Muir's Scottish Journey, with its travels among the pitbins of Lanarkshire, like a pygmy mockery of the romantic islands. I think it's much more miserablest than anything that Dermot said or wrote, because it identifies miserablism with Scotland's existence, with its very soul. It's got a lot to do with Edmund Muir himself, coming from Orkney, paradise to him, coming to the grim city, again in Glasgow, losing his family in all sorts of horrible ways, and feeling as if he'd moved from paradise to literally hell. And he tried to understand Scotland. I think that book, Scottish Journey, moves around in Scotland as if he's a complete stranger to it. And I think in some ways, we were kind of strangers to Scotland at that time because we just didn't know where it was. Of course, one reason that miserablism was so dominant in literature was not another myth, but the fact that for many it was true. The grim city during the Depression really was an inescapable fact for those who lived in it, as it was for those who lived in industrial cities everywhere. So again, we don't argue in this book that miserablism is wrong or untrue. Indeed, we think that the books mentioned here and many of the films represent high points of their medium. There were books and films that changed the way we looked at our things because they updated the way we saw ourselves. Miserablism can update and is flexible and can include positive or moves forward. Alan Sharps of NG and Getty examine the lives of young people in a supposedly new age of sexual freedom and finds postural industrial society beginning to rust, but still what traps the characters. Cuffy and Gibbon seem to escape to travel while Mosby stays. He has changed, Cuffy's girlfriend says when they return, but it's unclear how, while Mosby in his wanderings around the city seems to be alone in an empty city like a shell-shocked survivor. Interestingly enough, and it's been fascinating to look at film alongside literature in this respect, Alan Sharp's, the famous name of Alan Sharp, was he wrote one great book and then buggered off to Hollywood, Moves was going to be his third novel, if anyone knows Night Moves. It's partly written more as a novel than a screenplay. It's put into an American context. The hero of Night Moves is called Mosby. So, you know, you can trace it all the way through, and I enjoyed that aspect of it. Archie Hines, the dear being place in that book, Matt Craig seems to have found in the improved circumstances of the welfare state a way to write and be who he is, a young working class man from the tenements. It is not to be, as having given up his job, he finds his art becoming ugly and senseless, something he no longer understands or likes. As he kneels on the governed ferry, vomiting out his hopes and his ambitions in the city cast in iron, he finds all hope ended. Every road, no matter which one he takes, leading to failure. He's the fish that never swam, the bird that never flew. And getting up towards more contemporary times, William McIlvany's characters Doherty and Dan Schooler are two ends of a spectrum of decline in Greatonock, an Ayrshire mining town, in the novels Doherty and the Big Man. Proud, isolated and independent, embodying in his small frame all the courage and strength of his community, the only thing Doherty the miner has left by his death is his indomitable belief in protecting other people, the last redeeming feature in a dark picture of dwindling hope and opportunity. The warm, gritty community of Greatonock declines year after year as war, unemployment and increasing economic deprivation strip it further and further of its health. The community is beginning to collapse by the book's end. By the time we come to Dan Schooler's time in the 1980s, the miserablest hero has come into his own. Greatonock is afflicted by decades of unemployment and squalor, personified by Schooler himself, a wild, undisciplined, addicted brawler who can only drift through life from fight to fight, his only skill a big punch. His relationship is in danger, his children seem as if they will soon be fatherless, and there are no signs of redemption, only further disaster ahead. The Big Man is another of these that ticks most of the boxes, that are all of them on the miserablest list. The town, like himself, is purposeless and lost, its meaning long gone. He seems almost to escape his fate at the end of that book, protected by the last vestiges of his community, but his death at the hands of vengeful, violent gangsters is reported in the later novel, Strange Loyalties. The punishing god of fate gets him in the end. Same god that Eleanor mentioned, which he was talking about films. Miserablism is flexible and capable of updating to new circumstances. And in James Kelman's Not Not While the Gyro, the miserablest hero is an unemployed man surviving from gyro to gyro on tea and roll-ups in his bedside room. He lives in his thoughts and his imagination and is capable of almost anything there, including great joy and wild flights of fantasy. Kelman introduced, I think, a new existential intellectualism to the basic model. And although his characters can never escape their circumstances, because that's one of the defining factors of miserablism, their imaginations can almost surmount their circumstances. They can end almost in hope, but we know in fact they're back where they started. So these are some examples of miserablism from literature. I'm picking things out from the book and only quoting a little bit from the book, so there's more to be had if you want to get hold of it. I think miserablist texts are necessary at certain points. We're never saying it's always wrong. We want to say that it's made wonderful contributions. But between these high points have been many imitators, and particularly the exclusion of women's writing from all these forms. The domination of the masculine and miserablism is one of the things that we feel is one of the key aspects of it. At times, when the stereotype has become stuck, when the miserablest hero's message no longer has relevance, he's nothing left to tell us. Back to Ellen.
So I'm going to cheer you up, because one of the things I also thought would be really useful. schools to look at this massive contradiction within the Scottish psyche. So we get it, you've heard the argument traditionally with Jekyll and Hyde, you know, you've got R.D. Lane's divided south, you know, the idea that Scotland, how can Scotland both be miserablest but also of the kale yard, you know, wonderful, happy, bright, cheerful, loving people. I mean, interestingly, we talked there about Glasgow and, it, you know, the razor gangs and, you know, I mean, I know people in the south of England that think they won't come to Glasgow because they think they're going to get stabbed. And obviously, we just had the Commonwealth Games where they were saying it's the friendliest games in history. So one of the big conflicts, or one of the big things that I was pondering over was how can it be both of these things? How can Scottish culture be both this wonderful twee idyll and also this horrendous place full of people that just want to kill each other and selfishness? So what I decided to do was also alongside the content analysis was to have a look at films that people from outside Scotland had made about us. What do those films say? Okay, we're going to have a look at a roundup of that.
I never will have you seen the tavern anymore, eh, Charlie?
I have a days are over.
I used to be a roving lad, a roving and wandering life I had, on any land like brown moon, bright tiny down. Then one day I saw a maid, who held up her hand and stayed and stayed. And now across the green,
many years from now, would you be willing
may call it mythical, mythologized, idealized, romantic, nostalgic. But, you know, like James McPherson's Ossian, although it was ultimately a fake, it actually originated out of something authentic. You know, a story that was authentic oral folk tales. And what's really interesting here is, you know, these films talk about community. They talk about welcoming people. They talk about great landscape and beauty. They talk about men who go home from the pub to their wives. And strong, very strong, powerful female characters. That's what these films are talking about, none of which you'll see in Miserablism. So the films there were Brigadoon, then Powell and Press, which was Vincent Minnelli, Powell and Pressburger's I Know Where I'm Going, which basically features a very strong independent woman who actually favours the values of Scotland rather than the kind of consumerist, materialistic values of the southeast of England and the businessmen and that kind of thing. So she rejects those in favour of these wonderful values. Alexander McKendrick's Whiskey Galore, where the Scots unite together to overthrow the English who are trying to ruin their farm. And Mel Gibson, of course, his Braveheart, you know, where he is able to. And what's really funny and interesting there is we have a little cameo role by Peter Mullen, who is an arch miserablist, saying, no, we're going to stay and go to sleep, but we're not. And it's quite interesting because, you know, Peter Mullen does fall into the category. But if you would speak to Peter Mullen, he will tell you that he has pitched numerous ideas to commissioners. Many of them are not miserablist ideas, but it's the miserablist ones that they always want him to do. And he's now kind of become the stock miserablist hero. We've exported him all over the world. He plays that character in Canada, Ireland, England. So, you know, that's interesting that he's been kind of so typecast within that, and that there is a demand for that character outwith of the Scottish fiction. So what I wanted to just talk about briefly was, you know, somebody else who's quite interesting called Annie Griffin. And she, many of you will know her from the book group, which was Channel 4. The film festival, and actually very interestingly, a television pilot called Newtown, which was set in Edinburgh. How many of you actually saw that? Okay, one person who's in the industry, so I'm very suspicious.
I didn't edit it.
Well, what happened there, this is a great example of the kind of censorship that's now going on, because what I would say is you've got people like Peter McDougall, and we've got Bill Douglas, Peter McDougall, and up until that point, Miserablism was an actually very powerful protest movement. You know, it had a political edge and it was quite important. Thereafter, what happens after Trainspotting, which is a kind of pivotal moment in miserablism, is it becomes what I call faux miserablism in the book, which is simulacra, which is the idea of something that looks like a thing, smells like a thing, but is not that thing. So what you have is miserablism being repackaged and resold as an export with no political edge whatsoever. But selling our misery, if you like, abroad. So filth is a very good example of that. And actually what's interesting is that the money came from Germany and outside of Scotland for that. So, you know, this is kind of a thing that's kind of spreading, becoming more internationally liked as a version of ourselves. But Annie Griffin, she works against that. She is from outside. She's lived in Scotland for a couple of decades. She's American. She wanted to make a film about the middle classes in Edinburgh. Now, wouldn't that be quite interesting? We don't really see the middle classes on television, Scots middle classes. They seem to have been removed from our fictional viewing. You see it very, very rarely. She wanted to make it, she thought it would be great, and she came up with a series of characters which kind of were slightly unusual. We haven't really seen them much again in Scottish film and television. So we had a gay a couple who were gay architects with an adopted son. We had Danielle Nardini playing a very ruthless property developer who was extremely funny. and we had a character that comes from the Highlands to Edinburgh and seeing Edinburgh New Town and the hypocrisy and things through her eyes. So it was actually very interesting, and we saw a lot of characters that we haven't actually seen for a long time. What happens? Well, she's given about £500,000 for a visit, or is it, no, 50, I think it's £50,000. I'm not actually sure, it's in the book. She's given a substantial amount of public money to write a six-part series, which she goes ahead and does. They make the first episode, a 30-minute episode, and that did cost £500,000 of public money. It went out quite late at night, very few people saw it. The people who did see it, like A.A. Gill, who's a really quite harsh TV critic, actually said it was really interesting and it had legs and he'd love to see more of it. It was very refreshing to have Scots in this way. And then suddenly the whole series is cancelled and we never see it, even though all the episodes have been written and very good public money has been put into it and the critics receive it. But nobody really gets to see this and the series doesn't get made. And there are so many stories like that about the other diverse voices within Scottish culture. You know, think of The High Life, which is about the two gay air stewards. Only one series. It's a cult following now. A second series was never commissioned. We have things like Meet the Goons. We have people like John Byrne, who just inexplicably have never been commissioned to make very much more, who made The Cheating Heart, Tutti Frutti. And we also have the wonderful Bill Forsyth, whose film Gregory's Girl, which was one of the most successful Scottish films of all time, and made millions, 24 million at the box office, is now 34 years old. And Forsyth, like the Miserablest Hero, basically went into exile. He felt he couldn't grow here, he couldn't do bigger films, and he left for America. And like many of our great artists like Charles René McIntosh as well, you know, end up kind of floundering in exile because they're removed from what's mainland culturally, but they can't express it here, so they end up in a limbo. And there are many, many tales of Scottish artists like that. That's kind of where we are. It's very refreshing to see something like Sunshine and Leaf, but that is one film. But I'm going to leave you with Dave, who's going to give you a little bit more of a positive note before we wrap up. Thank you.
We have to kind of finish off. There's an awful lot more to be said. We finished the book by talking about a concept called wholeheartedness, which has been developed by academic Benny Brown, and is about being able to show your vulnerability as much as your other aspects. And we choose some possibly unlikely heroes for the future, non-miserablist heroes, Billy Connolly, Andy Murray, and most of all, in terms of the arts, Alistair Gray. What about the stories that Alistair Gray tells us for our time and for our future? Many of you will have been to Hillhead Underground. Those of you who haven't will know his mural there, who depicts all sorts of archetypes. We've got the miserablest heroes, of course, but we've also got lovely mums, hard workers, bold explorers, culture vultures, literary squirrels, wise old girls, and lots of others. And they're all potentials rather than what we have through the miserablest canon. We need to understand our fiction as an important national export, something of value and really quite cheap to produce. We're capable of it. We've got fantastic writers coming through, fantastic new writers coming through of all different sorts. It's time we realise the myriad of the heroines and heroes we're capable of. Our greatest export is the diversity of our fiction, and I believe that it's time we knew it. I'm going to finish off with a poem. Eleanor says I'm good at reading poems, so I'll go for it. My name is Scotland. I am an alcoholic. Sexism runs through me like a stick of rock. For all my blotchy pinkness, I am determined to be less prim about my gene pool, more airily cosmopolitan. To love my inner Mary, my floral clock, and John Thou Shalt Knox. I can live fine without nuclear subs. I've built far too many warships. All I want now is my dignity back, to stand on my own unsteady feet, sobered up, but not too sober, to renew my old alliance with this tipsy planet, my dependence and my independence. Thank you very much.